Laura Bush on C-SPAN was, somebody said her, you know, what are you reading? She said, I'm reading this. And George is reading the new book on Bonhoeffer, blah, blah, blah. I said, this is crazy. This is incredible. And sure enough, about a week ago, in the mail, I received a handwritten letter from George W. Bush. And I got to tell you, I am one of his huge fans, especially in New York City. There aren't so many of us, but even before he liked my book, I loved him anyway. So this was just a huge treat for me, and I've got to find the proper frame for this thing. But I'm just so excited about it. A lot of people have been reading the book, and as I say, it's a silly thing for an author to say that I'm amazed that people are reading the book, but I'm still humble enough and struggled enough that I don't take any of that for granted, even slightly, and I'm just moved by it. I want to say how I came to write the book before I tell you a little bit about Bonhoeffer. First of all, in 1988, the summer of 88, I really had a reconversion to my Christian faith. I was raised in the Greek Orthodox Church, but a lot of people sort of grow up in the church. You know, you go to college and you sort of drift away. I went to Yale, and so you don't drift away, you speed away, and you're, you know, shoved by the Yale faculty. I'm not saying if you've gone to Yale, you know, no offense, but they're aggressively secular. And so I graduated, you know, a gentleman and a nihilist as is proper. That's the whole point, right? And but in 88, I had this reconversion, and the guy who was really helping me to understand, to answer the intellectual objections I had to Christian faith, hands me this Bonhoeffer book. Says, "Have you heard of Bonhoeffer?" And I said, "No, I haven't heard of Bonhoeffer. I went to Yale. They don't teach you about Bonhoeffer at Yale." And he tells me the story about Bonhoeffer, that here was a man who, because of his Christian faith, stood up for the Jews, stood up against Hitler, got involved in the plot to kill Hitler, and was killed in a concentration camp in 1945. And I said, this is an amazing story. How come I've never heard this story before? It's scandalous. I was scandalized that I had never heard this story before of this amazing man. And I was particularly moved because I'm German. My mother grew up in Germany. Now, I always joke around, my father's Greek, so he's from Greece, hence my surname Metaxas. My mother's from Germany, hence my deep love for Siegfried and Roy. I just want to get that out of the way. Mostly Siegfried, but they're a team. But in all seriousness, you know, my parents are European immigrants to America, and the stories of World War II and what they lived through, of course, they lived through it in Greece and in Germany, these difficult, horrible stories. That's my life. I grew up in the shadow of their experiences in World War II. My grandfather was a reluctant German soldier. He was 31 years old. My mother, I never said this before publicly, my mother told me a couple weeks ago that he wept when he had to go. He did not want to go. He went in 1943. There were many Germans, you can imagine, who were not on board with what was happening. They certainly didn't want to risk their lives, especially for war that was already lost by 1943, and my grandmother used to say that he would listen to the BBC with his ear literally pressed against the radio speaker, because if you were caught listening to the BBC or to anything like that, you'd be sent to a concentration camp. It was not permitted. He was killed at age 31, a boy, and my mother was 9 years old. And so this story, this sad story, and the story of my family has always been with me. So when I heard in 1988 the story of Bonhoeffer, it sort of gave me a little hope that there were people. So there was someone who stood up. There was someone who stood up, obviously, for the Jews, but also for everyone else who was captive to this madman and his demonic vision for Germany and Europe and the world. So it's a personal story for me. And after I wrote the book on Wilberforce, some of you saw the film Amazing Grace. Actually, I'm always curious, how many of you saw the film Amazing Grace? Look at that, I must be in Texas. Incredible. They don't show those films in New York City. After I wrote that, I never planned to write a biography, but I was asked to write the biography. Wilberforce, and people, after it came out and it did reasonably well, people said, who will you write about next? And some people said, about whom will you next write? Those people were correct. You realize that. I'm a Yale English major. I'm going to preserve the word whom for future generations. I thought there is only one person who's ever lived besides William Wilberforce who captures my imagination, a hero of faith, a man who, because of his faith in God, stood up for those who had no power African Americans of that era. Wilberforce is a hero. There's only one other person. Bonhoeffer is the other person who, for me, his story needs telling. So that's, in a nutshell, how I came to write it. I had no idea it would be such a big book, but it's been 40 years since there's been a major biography of Bonhoeffer. And in fact, there's a lot of new material. I had no idea what I would have covered. I don't have a lot of time to go into that today, but there's a lot of stuff that I was really surprised and thrilled that I had the privilege to put this in my book so that everyone can read it and know the truth about it. But in a nutshell, Bonhoeffer's story. He was born in 1906 into what can only be described as an absolutely spectacular family. This family was impressive on every level, and this is a big piece of the puzzle in trying to understand Bonhoeffer, to understand his family. They were all big deals. His father, Paul Bonhoeffer, was the most famous psychiatrist in Germany for the first half of the 20th century. He was a hugely famous scientist, doctor, engineer, a big deal, and Bonhoeffer was his youngest son. There were four girls and four boys. All of Bonhoeffer's siblings were spectacular. I mean, it would have been difficult to compete in this family. His brother, Carl Friedrich, the eldest, decides to go into physics, and of course, for him, that means he's going to split the atom with Max Planck and Albert Einstein, which he did. I actually saw the atoms in a museum in Dresden. It's huge. They were much bigger in those days. And that's, thank you for knowing that that's a joke. But the idea that, you know, his brother decides he's going to go into physics, it means literally he's going to split the atom at age 23 with Einstein. This is the kind of family it was. They were academically really spectacular. But what's moving to me is that you read that, you know, every one of them was like that. They were all geniuses. The mother was a genius. They were really something. But they were also really good people. It's very clear that the children were trained to think, put others before yourself. You know, all that stuff they were supposed to actually do, they actually did this. And it's an amazing thing. And they were, most of them were heroes in World War II, not just Dietrich. But they really believed this. Now, the father, I should say, trained his children to think logically. He was a real scientist, and he trained them to think rigorously and logically, not to be sloppy in how you thought, but to think like a scientist with logic. And only to say something if you have something to say. If you don't have something to say or you don't know how to say it, shut up. Let somebody else talk. He really trained them that way. And I have to say, it would have been very intimidating to grow up at that dinner table because he meant that. But they were very gracious. They were very gracious. But Bonhoeffer grows up in this milieu. They had many friends in the academic world. They lived in the Grunewald section of Berlin, which was many academics. They had, of course, many Jewish friends. They were culturally incredibly sophisticated. The mother was quite a serious Christian, came out of the sort of Zinzendorf, Moravian, Herrnhuter movement. So it's a wonderful mix of the best of liberal, the best of conservative. I mean, it really is very rare that you get a picture of this kind of a family. So Bonhoeffer grows up in this family, and at age 14, to the shock, really, of his father and older brothers, announces that he wants to be a theologian. Now, this wasn't sort of a passing adolescent fantasy. Bonhoeffer was brilliant enough, and you know, in that family, you didn't say something and then change your mind 6 months later because you'd be, you know, tortured about it forever. So you just, Bonhoeffer, when he said he wanted to be a theologian at age 14, he actually meant it. But what he meant by that was that he wanted to distinguish himself, just the way his brother distinguished himself in the world of physics, and his other brother became the head of the legal department of Lufthansa, that he wanted to be an academically impressive theologian. And so he does just that. In a way, what he did, I think, is he took his father's rigorous, logical, scientific way of doing things and brought that into the world of theology. That's what he meant to do, and he did that. But it's almost funny, when he went to university, of course he went to Berlin University, which was the finest theological university in the world, all these living legends on the faculty, you know, this is where he's going to go. And he was so brilliant theologically that he had these living legends kind of competing for him to get him to write his dissertation under them. So they want to say, you know, that's my boy, you know, Bonhoeffer. And he was very independent. And so he just was a rising star academically. He gets his doctorate at age 21. Did anybody here get your doctorate at age 21? Truly, it's not in a big crowd like this. There must be a couple, right? No, actually, I didn't either, although I never tire of saying I'm currently working and getting my honorary doctorate. Thank you. Pretty good word for me. Well, Bonhoeffer gets his doctorate and then begins teaching. He spends a year. He found, because his big question, and I write about this a lot in the book, his question really was, ultimately, what is the church? He was asking this question. He went to Rome at age 17. He saw the Catholic Church. Now he's Lutheran. He sees this Catholic Church, all the people from every race celebrating Mass on the altar at St. Peter's on Palm Sunday. He begins to think about, what is the church? The church is something universal. It's not a racial thing. You can't be born Christian. You can be born a Gentile, but you can't be born a Christian. What is this? He's asking this question. He writes about it in his dissertation. In answering this question academically and theologically, he begins to understand that he actually likes working in church on a pastoral level, not just on a high theological academic level, but as a pastor. And so he spends a year in Barcelona as an assistant vicar. He enjoys preaching the gospel, so it's not just for him theory and theology, but he enjoys preaching to actual people, like some of us. And he likes to, teach Sunday school. He likes to take these highfalutin theological ideas and actually translate them so that children can understand them, because he thinks, what validity do they have if we can't actually explain them to normal people, to children? He couldn't get ordained until he was 25, so at age 24 he decides to kill a year to spend a year at Union Theological Seminary in New York City. Now I should say, around this time, his twin sister, to whom he was very, very close, marries a Jewish man. So this issue of what the future holds for him was very personal for him. Obviously now his dearest brother-in-law is ethnically Jewish, even though he had converted to some kind of Christianity and baptized. But this was an issue for him, and he goes now to Union at age 24. This is interesting because Bonhoeffer had already gotten his doctorate at 21 from Berlin University, so he could have easily taught circles around most of the people who were teaching at Union. But he goes there humbly as a Sloan fellow, and he was not impressed by what passed for theology, that's his phrase, at Union. He was not academic, he was not theologically liberal, but he respected his theological liberal professors at Berlin. New York, not so much. He was not impressed by what was passing for theology, as he said it. So he didn't seem to get much out of it theologically, but what happened that year was very significant. He was invited by a fellow student, an African-American Alabama named Frank Fisher, to attend a service at Abyssinian Baptist Church in Harlem. Bonhoeffer goes with Fisher up to Harlem. This is the fall of 1930. And what he sees in this congregation of African Americans in 1930 absolutely staggered him, moved him profoundly. Here was a congregation of suffering people. He could see this, that they really believed what they were talking about in the church. In other words, their worship, as they sang these Negro spirituals, as he put it, they were really singing these songs as though they were more than songs, as though they were actually worshiping a living God. They seemed to have a personal relationship with God. He didn't find this in the Lutheran circles in which he'd been traveling so much. He was moved by the preaching. Adam Clayton Powell Sr., born in 1865, a legend in terms of preaching, just a huge legend, somebody who preached really fiery, passionate gospel message of Jesus Christ, but combined it with actually living it out in the community, helping the poor, all this stuff. Bonhoeffer never seen the two together on this level. He was so moved by what he found in this church that he vowed to go back every single Sunday that he was in New York City. So for 9 months, he went back to Harlem. Now, the thing, it's almost funny. He's a tow-headed, respectable Berlin academic going up to Harlem in 1930 and 31 every Sunday, not just to worship in his church of African Americans, but to teach Sunday school, to get involved in the lives of the people there. It was a profoundly life-changing experience for him. And when he went back to Germany, people really did feel that he was somehow different. His faith was different. It's not that his theology changed, but his heart changed somehow. He seemed to take it more seriously. Another thing that happened to him, which I don't want to forget to say, 1931, which is amazing, and I think half of what makes my book interesting is that I take stuff that already was out there, but I sort of underscore it three times just so you don't miss it, because it's sometimes I'm amazed by things, and I say, how come people aren't jumping up and down about this amazing fact that I found? One thing that I mean by this is that in Easter of 1931, now, Bonhoeffer was in America for one Easter in his life. That was 1931. What did he do on that Easter? He wanted to go to one of those big, you know, white Protestant churches, Fifth Avenue, where just experience, you know, what that's like. And as you know, I don't know what it's like here, but in New York, on Easter, that's when the Gentiles go to church. You know, on Sundays, every Sunday, it's the Christians go. But on Easter, that's the Gentiles go. And very crowded, a lot of Gentiles in New York City. And so Bonhoeffer tries to go to one of these churches and finds that it is so crowded, you literally need tickets to go to the Easter service. And of course, coming from Berlin, he didn't know about this in advance, so he didn't have a ticket. So he was boxed out. He could not go to church, to one of those churches. Where did he go on the one Easter that he was in America, Easter Sunday? Where did he go? He went to hear Rabbi Stephen Wise preaching. His congregation, obviously Jewish congregation, was so big that they met at Carnegie Hall. Bonhoeffer went to hear Rabbi Stephen Wise preach. And it's been my privilege to get to know Rabbi Stephen Wise, Wise's grandson, also named Stephen Wise. He loves Bonhoeffer and knows more about Bonhoeffer than you'd ever imagine. It's just extraordinary to meet him, and he's 82 now, and a delightful person. But I just thought, what an interesting thing that Bonhoeffer is in a synagogue listening to a rabbi on the one Easter that he's in America with no knowledge of what the future holds for him. In just about a few years, his whole faith will be inextricably intertwined with the Jews of Europe. No idea. So he goes to this synagogue. In any case, we know he comes back to Germany in 1931. He's different. People notice this. He's saying things from the lectern, the university lectern, which you barely heard from pulpits in Germany at the time. He's talking about the Bible as the Word of God. Now, you hear that, you know, in Harlem at Abyssinian Baptist Church. You would not hear that from Berlin theological faculty lecterns. He starts talking about politically how Germany is looking for a savior, and people understand that it's in Hitler that they're looking. They want somebody to take them out of the shame of Versailles, this horrible economic situation. He starts saying that, no, if we're German Christians, there is only one savior for us. Our Messiah is Jesus. And he was very pointed about that. And this is a big deal, because obviously, you know, the climate in Germany at this time was not favorable to people talking like this. But it culminated in, obviously, 1933, January 31st, Hitler becomes chancellor. 3 days later, Bonhoeffer comes on the radio and gives a famous speech in which he dissects the whole concept of what's called the Führer principle. That's a chapter in my book, because it's very important to understand that the Führer principle was this philosophical idea that really paved the way for Hitler, and Hitler rode this idea into the chancellorship and, you know, wrote it off a cliff 12 years later, dragging Europe and the world with him. This idea was an idea that 3 days after Hitler becomes chancellor, Bonhoeffer goes on the radio and dissects this idea, shows it to be a tautology, shows it to be a snake swallowing its own tail. Doesn't make sense philosophically. Very brave for Bonhoeffer to do this, but he was on the record immediately, let's say, against where the Nazis were going. Well, we know the story, and I cover a lot of this history in the book because I think a lot of people, I mean, you may know it, but a lot of people don't really know what was happening, and to understand what was happening in Germany, to understand Bonhoeffer, you need to understand the history. And you know that Hitler was very, very ruthless and fast in bringing about changes in Germany. He didn't buy his time. He was instantly transforming all of society. And Bonhoeffer, obviously, as a pastor, was involved in the Kirchenkampf, the church struggle, because the Nazis had no problem in infiltrating the church and saying that, you know, if we're going to take over society, we're also going to take over the church. We're going to put our people in the church. Now, that makes some sense because they didn't have a separation of church and state, and the Kaiser had been the head of the church. And, you know, not having a separation of church and state isn't necessarily so bad if you've got the head of the state, you know, who is okay. But, you know, if it's Adolf Hitler, you've got some problems. And so Bonhoeffer really understands that this cannot work. And again, bringing his father's scientific mind to this equation, to look at it and to say, you know, where are we? So we have to think this through. He was sort of a pioneer in terms of thinking this through, because many German pastors, many Germans in general, they were confused by these issues of whether the state and the church should be separated, and how, and what does this mean, and what are the limits of the church, what are the limits of the state, when is the state encroaching on the church? They really, most of them, we're not very sophisticated in thinking about this. So Bonhoeffer is really leading the way, helping them understand that the state is now overshadowing the church, and that's not okay. That's not okay. The things that the church, in a sense, has to be the conscience of the state. And so he was in the thick of this battle, one of the leaders in this battle, trying to get the German pastors and other theologians to understand that what the Nazis were doing on any number of levels was wrong. It was antithetical to the Christian faith. You can do what you want, but you can't call it Christianity. And they were infiltrating theologically. I mean, it almost becomes absurd. They were trying to, in a sense, establish a kind of pseudo-Christian theology that cut out all Jewishness. Now, if you know the most basic things about Christian theology, you know that if you cut out Jewishness, good luck with that project, because you're not really going to have anything left. I believe, wasn't Jesus quite Jewish? I think even Jesus was maybe quite Jewish. Maybe he was even a rabbi with a beard. I don't know. Something I heard. Wasn't his mother, I think even his mother was Jewish. And I think, Matthew, Mark, John, I think they were. I think that Paul and Peter, I think, you're going to have a problem with this. But if you're really, really, a national socialistic ideologue, you're going to be, we can work it out. We'll figure it out somehow. We'll create a theology. And it's, on the one hand, funny, and on the other hand, just deeply tragic that this was actually happening in Germany. So Bonhoeffer, on any number of levels, sees where this is going and is fighting. I think of him as a Jeremiah-like prophet. He saw what other people somehow could not see. He saw where this was going. He understood what we know is true, and what I write about in my book, at length, is that the top Nazis were bitter enemies of serious Christians. Bitter enemies. Now, that story's not been told. If you conflate, being a Gentile with being a Christian, that won't be so clear. But if you understand what Bonhoeffer did, that the Nazis were, they were politically savvy enough never to be public about this, at least not until the war had started. But they would pretend, they would say things, they would, use God's name in vain, because they knew that they would lose politically. But behind the scenes, and there's tons of documentation, and I write about it in the book, they were bitter enemies of serious Christians. And so if you were merely a church-going Gentile, they didn't have a problem with you. But if you were a serious Christian, they had big problems with you, and as we will soon see. So Bonhoeffer, he sees this, he's trying to wake up the church, and he was not so successful. They wrote something called the Barman Declaration, a famous moment where they, a document that basically tears the confessing church away from the Reich Church, the German state church, which had just become heretical, utterly heretical. And Bonhoeffer was one of the leaders in drafting this Barman Declaration and getting some pastors, quite a few pastors actually, to stand up against this Nazified Reich Church. But the fact of the matter is that the Nazis were so ruthless and vicious and aggressive that unless you were like Bonhoeffer, it was hard to see what they were doing. They were very obviously very canny, very clever. So Bonhoeffer gets tired of this battle because he feels that his fellow pastors don't understand the urgency, that unless we draw a line here and are willing to die on this line, we're losing. The Nazis are winning and we are losing. Bonhoeffer kept trying to wake the church up to say that we can win. There are many Germans, if we lead them, there are many Germans that they will understand. But if we're mealy-mouthed about this, if we think, well, we need a little more dialogue, if we don't understand that we've got to be aggressive and fighting and willing to die, we will lose. And in fact, that's just what happened. In 1934 and 35, sort of disgusted, Bonhoeffer escapes to London for 18 months to lead a German-speaking congregation there just to get away from Berlin and this battle. But eventually he's called back to lead an illegal seminary, first at Zingst on the Baltic Sea, and then Finkenwalde, because the confessing church, the good guys in this story, they had no seminaries, and they knew that the other seminaries were not exactly putting out theologically orthodox Christians. And so Bonhoeffer leads one of these seminaries, and that's a whole chapter or two in the book. It's kind of the golden era of Bonhoeffer, where he's able to try to train these young men what it really means to be a Christian, and not just to be a Christian in name, but to live it, to learn how to pray, to learn from trying to listen and hear from God. All of these things are fundamental. If you want to be a Christian leader, you have to know how to do these things. It's not just academic theology. It's not just ideas. It has to be your life. Your life has to be your theology. People don't see God in your life. then it's just words. It's dead religion, and it's worse than nothing. So Bonhoeffer spent a number of years training these young seminarians. As I said, it was illegal. The Gestapo was closing in. Eventually, they shut down Zingst and Finkenwalde. Then the whole thing goes underground. It becomes like a floating craps game. They're doing it here. They're doing it there. And Bonhoeffer was very, very canny about all of this. But we know how the story ends. The Gestapo were tightening the noose, constantly tightening the noose. So eventually, Bonhoeffer's unable to lead the seminary anymore. He was banned from speaking publicly at a certain point. But they did this in stages. It's really extraordinary how the Nazis did this. So he can no longer speak publicly. He wrote a book. You know, if you want to poke a stick in the Nazis' eyes, you know, write a book as a theologian on the Psalms, which some of you may know is in the Old Testament. Bonhoeffer writes a book on the Psalms, which was really just incendiary at that time. So he's now banned from publishing. So his possibilities of serving and resisting are more and more closed down. Finally, the war is coming in 1939. He decides to go back to America, in a sense to escape the war, not to escape to preserve his life, but really he didn't know what he could do anymore in Germany. He certainly wasn't going to pick up a rifle and fight in the war. So he goes to America, but no sooner is he on the ship than he knows, because he's praying, that he knows God is calling him back. He doesn't feel free to escape. So he gets to America, and in 26 days, he's on another ship heading back into what is obviously great danger. But he felt that God himself was leading him. And if God is leading you, if you're a smart person, you go. And Bonhoeffer understood, God is leading me to stand with my people. I've made a mistake. That chapter in my book is the first time that story has ever been fully told. This amazing decision, this great decision of his life to go back to Germany in the midst of all of this that's going on around him. But it's a beautiful story, what he experiences during those 26 days, and I'm very glad to tell it. He goes back. What's he going to do now? The war has started. Well, this is where he makes the big leap, and I won't go into the theology because we were out of time, but basically Bonhoeffer decides, his family were at the center of the conspiracy against Alfie. His brother-in-law, Donani, was one of the heads of German military intelligence, which was the center of the conspiracy against Adolf Hitler. Donani had been talking to Bonhoeffer, the family had been talking secretly about this conspiracy against Hitler, had been involved in it in different ways. Bonhoeffer had been providing the moral support of the pastor. He'd been part of this, but now he decides God is calling him to get involved officially, to officially enter the conspiracy. So his brother-in-law, now remember the war has just started, his brother-in-law hires him to work for German military intelligence, ostensibly to help the Third Reich during this time of war. But in reality, what Bonhoeffer was doing and what his brother-in-law knew he was doing and what the other leaders in the Abwehr knew he was doing was he was participating in this conspiracy against Hitler and the Nazis to bring the Nazis down, culminating in the assassination of Hitler and his top lieutenants. This is the plan. Bonhoeffer officially now gets involved and becomes effectively a double agent, right? Working for German military intelligence, but in fact, working against the Nazis. So this is what happens to him. His job really was to use his ecumenical contacts around Europe to make contact with the Allied governments, most notably Anthony Eaton and the Churchill government, to let them know that there are Nazis inside Germany working against, that there are Germans inside Germany working against Hitler and the Nazis, to let the Allied powers know. So that's how he was used in this. There's a lot more to the story. In 1943, he gets engaged. I'm speeding ahead here. That's another story that's never really been told until this book, which I don't know how that happened. It's an amazing story of this love affair and this engagement, but I tell that story. And no sooner is he engaged in 1943 than the Gestapo finally catch up with him and with German military intelligence and the folks in there. And Bonhoeffer's arrested, sent to take a military prison. Why was he sent there? Not for the conspiracy against Hitler. Where they had caught him was he was involved in something called Unternehmen 7, which is Operation 7, an operation to get seven German Jews out of Germany and into neutral Switzerland. Bonhoeffer had been involved in this. He gets arrested, but he doesn't think he's going to go to his death. This was, they hadn't uncovered a conspiracy yet. So he's in prison, really thinking that this is going to come to trial and he will be exonerated. He feels that he's going to get out. Beautiful letters between him and his fiance. And also, while he's in prison, he understands that the conspiracy is continuing out there, that Hitler is going to be killed, the war is going to end, the Allies are going to win, this is going to be over soon. Well, the culmination of this conspiracy is the Valkyrie plot, something we saw the Tom Cruise movie with Stauffenberg, brings the briefcase July 20th, 1944 to the Prussian military headquarters, plants it under the table, it explodes, people are killed, Hitler survives. And now, for the first time in about 8 years that this conspiracy has been bubbling along and trying to kill Hitler and failing, and trying to kill Hitler and failing and conspiring, for the first time, the conspiracy has exploded, forgive the pun, wide open, so that now it's exposed, I should say. It's utterly exposed. Everybody is arrested. People are tortured. Names come up. One of the names is Dietrich Bonhoeffer. So Bonhoeffer's already in Tegel military prison. Now they know, the Nazis know, that he's been involved not just in a plot to get some Jews out of Germany, which is bad enough, but he's been trying to kill the Führer. So Bonhoeffer's now transferred to the Gestapo prison. From here on in, we know that his days are numbered. He's eventually transferred to Buchenwald in February of 45. There's still some hope that he may be used as a pawn, that the Nazis will trade him and some other top-level prisoners as the war is winding down. It doesn't end that way, obviously. On the express orders of Hitler, on April 9th at dawn, Bonhoeffer is transferred to Flossenbürg concentration camp in Bavaria, where he's hanged at dawn on April 9th. And most of us are tempted to think of that as mainly, or I should say, as merely a sad story. I have to say, Bonhoeffer would have rebuked us. He would have said, no, I was obeying God. I was doing everything I did in obedience to God. We're all going to die. The question is not whether you're going to die. The question is how you're going to die. Are you going to obey God and give him everything you have with your life? That's the question. And for him to go to his death knowing that he had been doing what God called him to do, again, that's more complicated. But if you read the book, you'll understand what I mean by that. I think that there was a deep peace. I think there's plenty of evidence that there was a peace and a joy as he went to his death, knowing that he's going into the arms of the God that he loves and serves. And so I think it's important to think about and to understand that, a martyr's death, on the one hand it's sad, and on the other hand it's happy, it's beautiful, it's the most beautiful way that any of us can go out of this world. So, let me stop there. We're way over time. I think we have a few minutes for Q&A. Thank you.
Inspiring, and you can imagine it inspired me a lot. So, yes, thank you.
Let's have a look in the audience.
Absolutely not. Next question. Actually, I don't. In all fairness, I don't have much to say about that. I won't pretend to be enough of a scholar to talk about that. I don't think that there actually is much there. I mean, he studied under Niebuhr. I don't know how much it influenced him. There are Niebuhr scholars and Bonhoeffer scholars who would have much more to say about that than I did. I mean, Niebuhr was a personality. You know, Bonhoeffer had contact with him. Niebuhr, I mean, in some ways, Bonhoeffer was not so impressed with some of the stuff that Niebuhr wrote. But Niebuhr is the recipient of a letter that Bonhoeffer wrote in 1939 when he decides to leave New York. I mean, Niebuhr had pulled strings so that he could come, so that Bonhoeffer could come to New York. And Bonhoeffer writes this famous letter I quoted in the beginning of the chapter of this period where he says, I have made a mistake and I have to go back to Germany. I think he felt he owed it to Niebuhr to explain this to him and to say that I have to go back to Germany. Anyway, I'll stop there. I don't want to say anything that's so complicated. Yes, sir. Well, that's kind of the big theological question for Bonhoeffer, about Bonhoeffer, because people, you know, the big question, if we had 45 minutes or more, we could really go into this, but basically people always want to say, well, how is it possible for this pastor to get involved in a plot, you know, to kill somebody? Well, what is that? And I think the beauty of Bonhoeffer, and this is why I'm so excited about Bonhoeffer, is he challenges us to think more deeply and like his father, the scientist, to think more rigorously about these questions. Not to sort of, in a cheap religious way, say, oh, the Bible says thou shalt not kill, the Bible says thou shalt not lie, that's that. What do you mean that's that? What does it mean to lie? What does it mean to tell the truth? If somebody says, is there a Jew in your basement? As a good Christian, am I supposed to say, oh yes, please, right this way. Is that the will of God? What is the will of God? What does it mean to lie? What does it mean to tell the truth? What does it mean to get involved in a plot against somebody who you know is murdering millions of innocent people? What does it mean to stand for God? I think Bonhoeffer challenges us, and this period of history challenges Bonhoeffer. You have to now think more deeply about this. You don't have easy religious answers. Now God is challenging you with demonic evil, destructive evil on a level that the world has hardly ever seen. And now we're going to find out what kind of faith you have. You just have cheap, easy religious faith that you think you know what you're talking about, but now you're going to be challenged. Now you're going to be sifted. We're going to see what's left. That's the situation of Bonhoeffer, and that's why I think he's a challenge to us today, because he takes these things very seriously. He writes about them in his book, Ethics, and I quote some of that in my book, and I deal with this question in the book as well, because I think that he challenges us to think more deeply about these things and say, well, what does God say? What does God really say to do in this situation? And Bonhoeffer did not enter the conspiracy to assassinate Hitler lightly. And he even thought that he might be wrong. This is what he felt God was saying, but you know, he thought, well, if I'm wrong, I cast myself on the grace of God, on the mercy of God, forgive me, but I'm going to act to do what I think God is calling me to do, rather than be living a kind of fear-based religion where it's all about me not making a mistake, or not sinning, or not doing this, or not doing that. He said, that's not Christianity. Christianity is to try to serve God actively, obedience to his will, which is a far cry from simply trying to avoid sin, and don't do this, and don't do that. And that's really what excites me about Bonhoeffer's theology, and why I'm excited about Bonhoeffer in general, because he gets us to think along those lines. So, do you have time for another question? Yes, sir. Could you say that louder? Yeah, I guess I said it loud enough. Right. Could you email all your friends? Well, the question is about this double life that he was leading as an agent for the out there. I mean, just imagine this. Okay, imagine you're Dietrich Bonhoeffer. You have been an outspoken let's say, you've been outspokenly against the Nazis, and you have been kind of, you know, if somebody is not really serious about their faith, they would think of Bonhoeffer as a holier-than-thou pain in the neck. Like, he just wish he'd shut up. Who does he think he is, you know, telling me how to live? We all have friends like that, right? And but the fact of the matter is, Bonhoeffer was so serious about his faith that he was a challenge to anybody who was lukewarm about their faith. He was really living this. He was authentic to the bottom. Well, imagine if that guy suddenly, war comes, and now he's working for German military intelligence. Now he's working, you know, with the Nazis, it seems. He's got to be kidding. What a hypocrite. What a bum. Well, this is where following God becomes lonely. And if you really follow God, it becomes lonely. Because God knows what he's called you to do, and you know that he knows. But your friends and your colleagues, they may not think so well of you. So the question is, if you do what you do to impress your colleagues and your friends and the people in your community, or do you do what you do out of obedience to God? Bonhoeffer knew that many friends, including Karl Barth, this is an amazing thing, that Bonhoeffer's hero in some ways is Karl Barth, that they looked at him now with a jaundiced eye. They go, what has happened to you? And, you know, during wartime when people are picking up rifles and dying, and you're flying around Germany and going to neutral countries and going to movies and things, and, you know, a nice life you carved out for yourself, a hypocrite, you know. And many people were thinking that about him. And so it's an extraordinary thing that he was comfortable with these layers of deception because he thought, ultimately, I'm doing what God is calling me to do. And if the only person who understands this is God, that's fine with me. But that doesn't make it easier. But it's a whole story.
Eric, I also, I'm one of those who I would say your book has changed my life, so I really appreciate the immense work that you definitely put in this book. But I was wondering whether you have ever thought about when did Bonhoeffer's life with God begin? As a German theologian or the Abyssinia Baptist Church experience?
I think both, and that's why I think that, you know, as a self-described evangelical, I think evangelicals often have a very a simplistic view of salvation. Bonhoeffer was a Christian as a young man. It seems obvious to me when I read what he wrote. He took his faith seriously. His grandfather and great-grandfather were rather famous theologians. His mother was a serious Christian. He took all this seriously. But he writes in some letters, which I quote in the book, that something happened to him as a result of this time in New York, it seems, that changed his faith. To the point that he almost described it as he became a Christian as a result of this. Now, that's Bonhoeffer being typically humble and gracious, because anybody else would say that's ridiculous. You already were, you know, a finer Christian at age 20 than most people who claim to be Christians. You already believed this, but something happened clearly, and he writes about this, that he actually seems to think that this was when he gave God his life. He sort of, you know, he'd been living for himself, very impressive as an academic and some sort of, but somehow this ambition, this selfish ambition went away, and he understood that God has chosen me. And I think that it's true of the Jews, it's true of the prophets. To be chosen by God is a glorious and a terrible thing. And you know, it's not like getting a gold star. It's a humbling thing. And Bonhoeffer understood this, and that's why the title of the book is Pastor, Martyr, Prophet. Spy. I really believe that he was a prophet in the sense that he was chosen like Jeremiah, and he was not giddy about being chosen. He understood it was a terrible burden, but he accepted it. That's the message of this book. What does it mean to be chosen by God to serve?